Hi everyone, this is Santosh Kumar DK, Assistant Professor, Department of Computer Science and Engineering, Canara Engineering College, Mangaluru. I am going to discuss Computer Organization course with subject code 18CS34. In this course, we will study the organization of the digital computer, the peripheral connections, memory organization, and also the little bit discussion about ALU and CU working. The study material regarding this course is available on the given website. You are free to refer the website for the study material. Let's see what is computer organization and why we have to study. The computer organization is concerned with the structure and behavior of a digital computer as seen by the user. It's only going to discuss how the hardware components are being organized rather than discussing in detail with the architecture behavior. It deals with the components connections, which we call it as a interfacing. So it's going to discuss how the components has been interfaced with the computer hardware. It tells how exactly all the units like ALU, CU in the system are arranged and how they are interconnected with the memory and other registers and how they are going to work together to accomplish a task. The main objective of this course is to understand overall basic computer hardware structure, including the peripheral devices, memory organization, ALU, and the working of both. The textbooks referred by the university for this is given over here. So out of that textbook, you can refer these chapters for the prescribed syllabus, and there is a reference book, and for more information you can refer the reference book also. We have seen the computer where we have seen the computer will be having many components like a monitor, keyboard, mouse, speaker, printer, and CPU, and again CPU consists of many other components. So this is what we have seen as an overview of the computer, and when we are going to categorize them, like those parts inside the computer and what you can see in the computer, can be directly categorized into two parts. One is the hardware, the other one is the software. The hardware is the one which you can touch and feel, where you can get a physical feeling by touching them. That we call it as a hardware. The other one is the software, which you cannot touch, which we call it as a like soul of the computer, which works in a virtual way. So what we are going to study in this subject is, we are not discussing anything much about these softwares, and we are going to discuss more about these hardware components, how they are, what are the purpose of them, how they are connected, how they can be used, and what is the benefit of using these things, and how they can be interfaced to the computer, and how they work together to accomplish a task. Let's see, whatever the devices I have shown in the previous slide, hardware devices, can be categorized into any of these. It can be a input device, or it can be a output device, or it can be a memory device, or it can be a processing. In the processing again, we are having arithmetic and logic unit and control unit. So any device which we are going to get it to the computer, which should belong to any of these categories. So we'll study how these are going to work. In the module 1, what we are going to discuss is, we are going to see the basic structure of computer and machine instructions and program. And the module 1, the first part of the module 1 is covered with the textbook 1, with the chapter number 1.1 to 1.6. And the machine instruction and program is covered from 2.2 to 2.10 from the chapter 2, from the first textbook 1, which I have shown in the previous slides. First concept is basic operational concepts. Before that, I just wanted to give you a demo. Actually, we have already introduction to C language. So why this computer organization we need to study? Because whatever the programs we are going to write, that will be converted to machine language, and that will be run by the machine, which we know from the first year. So here I just want to show you how this C program. See, here I have taken a simple C program where it's adding two numbers A and B. A is having a value 10 and B is having a value 20, and the sum of A and B will be stored in C, and I'm going to return. This is a simple add function which is going to perform the task in the C program. And now the same will be converted to assembly language. This is the assembly language code, and we know there is a software called compiler which is responsible for converting a high level language to low level language. So the definition of the compiler is going to convert the given source code in high level language to object code. So it means it's not exactly the machine code, it's the architectural dependent code. So the architectural dependent code, we call it as a assembly language. So here you can see the assembly language for this architecture. The architecture what I have shown over here, x86-64 Clang architecture, for that I have got this. So the same code which I have written in C is converted to this. Whenever we compile a program on the respective architecture, based on the architecture, this type of code will be generated, and that is run by the computer. This is going to be run by the computer, not this one. This has to convert, and we can see here I have done two initializations. A is 10 and B is 20, and C is undefined. So these declarations are done over here. See, you can check the value 10 and value 20 is stored in some memory. That memory is a data word. D word is a data word, and PTR, because it has to go to the memory, we need a reference where we are going to use a pointer, and it's going to have a memory location. These are address resolution which we are going to study in the next coming part of this module. So next we are having a effective address calculation, because I want to fetch those values when I want to add it. These three lines are responsible for adding those two variables and storing the answer back to the variable C. Next, what we are going to do over here is we are going to get this from the respective data word, from the respective location. You can notice the same location, RSP. RSP is a pointer, the base pointer, which will be used to get the values. So it's going to actually, RSP is a stack pointer. It's going to get the value from the stack because it's a local variable. Local variables are stored in the stack. So now what we are going to do is we are going to get that particular location value, and we are going to store in a auxiliary effective address is calculated, and it will be stored in the temporary register. And again, what I will do is I'll directly add that with the one more operand. See, when you are performing a addition operation, the architecture, it depends on the architecture. I'll show you the various version of this code. Only for this code, for this addition of two number, based on the architecture after this discussion. Now I am having one operand over here. Next, what I will do is I will get directly the other operand. I need not to fetch it to the register. This is a register. Directly I will add it. So it means one operand is already there in the register. The another operand can be directly taken from the memory. But both operands cannot be there in the memory in this architecture. It might be in different architecture, they may support, but this architecture, whatever I have chosen, it's not going to support. Both the operands can be there in the memory, directly cannot, addition operation cannot be done. Next, what I am doing is, once after that, see, the 4 and 8 and 12, you know that int means 4 bytes, right? At 4th location, I am having the one variable, 8th location, I am having one more variable, and you can see that at the 12th location I am having another variable where I am going to store the answer. You can see here, so the answer of this will be fetched to this. It means this is the source, this is the destination. Again, these source and destination also vary from architecture to architecture. And you can see here OXC, it means OXC is a hexadecimal version. So if it, 12 is a decimal version. Next, finally, what I am going to do, I'll move that and I'm going to come out of that particular function. So this is how a simple addition of two number program in C, function in C, is converted to assembly language. Actually, what we are going to discuss is purely based on this type of executions. Actually, our computer internally works like this, even though we say it can understand the high level language. So I'll just show you the demonstration that how it differs from one architecture to another architecture. I'm changing the architecture over here. Yes, I'll go with the other one. Taking time. Yeah, you can check out over here. It's a little bit different from the previous version where I'm having here push and all, like push and pop will be used whenever a function is called. All the previous variables of the previous function will be preserved in our stack, and it will be popped out once you are going to come out of the function. But this is again based on different architectures. We are going to get different. See, again here we are going to get a different version. This is purely based on the architecture. Even we might be people have heard about ARM processor. Yes, we are having an ARM processor over here, and you might have heard about Raspberry Pi, and we are having a Raspberry Pi also. Here Adrian, Arduino, and Raspberry Pi. All these, see, you can check out a simple program how it is converting to, and actually this is what those respective architecture can understand. So now you got an idea that how the given C program is converted to the machine dependent format and how it is going to be executed. Now let's see, let's go back to our discussion. Yes, why I have discussed all this, because all these what we are going to discuss in this course are purely based on the assembly language. Even though we say that we are writing a program in high level language, but internally it has to convert to the lower level. See, this is what the diagram where it's going to show how our computer is organized. We had a habit of discussing this type of diagram always, right? Input device, output device, memory, and arithmetic and logic unit. This is the basic diagram we had always we have written. But internally, because we are going to master these organizations, we are going to write in detail diagram of that. Before we know, inside a processor, we have only ALU, CU, and memory. But right now, we are getting more people over there. Yep. Right now, we have all this. We'll see what is the purpose of each. So first, we are having a register called MAR. MAR stands for Memory Address Register. It's a unidirectional connected. It's connected with a unidirectional bus to the memory. It means only it can send an address to memory, main memory. It means ROM or RAM. Actually, it is going with the RAM over here, not ROM, because the ROM is used initially when we start the machine. Later on, we will not use a ROM. Later on, we'll go with the RAM only. So it's going to send an address from this register to the main memory. The main memory is not cannot able to send it back that address to MAR because it is unidirectional. Then we are having MDR, memory data register. So what is the job of this is it can store the data which is residing inside MDR to the memory, or it can fetch the data from main memory to MDR. Both is accepted. That's why we are going to show here with a bidirectional communication. This is a unidirectional, this is a bidirectional. And next we are having a control unit, which we call it as a mind of the hardware, like because it is the one which is going to control complete system. So now the control unit is responsible for generating the sequence of control signals which are going to be used to control the all the devices inside the computer, and these are having a bidirectional connection with the memory. Why? Because even control device can tell, read some respective location from the memory, which is given, the address is given by MAR. MAR is already having the address. It's going to tell you, yeah, from this address you read some locations. But what if that location is not available? If there is some issue with the location, so or else the data does not found or something, that location itself is not available, then it's going to send some signals back to this. Or else if it is going to read those locations, and if it's going to store in MDR, it has to tell I have completed the task. You said me to read, I did it, It has to tell it back to the control unit so that control unit can tell the other people to do the task. But this what they have made the connection between communication between main memory and the control unit as bidirectional rather than unidirectional. Notice there is a only unidirectional communication between main memory and memory address register and bidirectional communication between memory data register and the control unit. Next we are having on the next level PC. PC stands for program counter. Please remember it's a program counter. So the program counter job is it is going to hold the address of the next instruction to be executed. Please remember it's going to hold the address of next instruction. It means it's not going to hold the address of the current instruction, it's going to hold the address of the next instruction. Why? Because one, the current instruction is already in the stage of execution, everything. By that time, the PC should be having a next instruction so that the data can be, the next instruction can be fetched as fast as possible and the task can be completed. Next, we are having at the next level IR. IR stands for instruction register. It's going to have the instruction which is currently executing. This is having a address. This is also having the address. This is having the next instruction address. This is having the address which is given by this person, PC. But IR is having the instruction. It's having an instruction which is currently executing. So whatever the instruction which is currently executing, which is held by the instruction register. And when you are doing tasks, you need some places where you can store the temporary content. So for that, what we are going to do over here is we are going to use some general purpose registers, which are responsible for holding the temporary results. So those are named as R0 to Rn-1. So what is the n value? It purely varies from one architecture to other architecture. And in this subject, we are not going to study a particular architecture, we are going to study the general architecture. We are not going to study Intel architecture, we are not going to study AMD architecture, or we are not going to study some other architecture. We are going to study the general architecture. So that's why we are going to speak everything in a general way. We are not going to be particular about the things. Next, after that, we have something called ALU. We heard about this ALU. ALU is the one which is responsible for arithmetic and logical operation. Any operation inside the computer should be done through the ALU, and everything should be controlled by the CU. These two are the main components of computer. So whenever ALU is performing any task, for example, instruction register is having an instruction called addition. So that is the job it has to do. When it is performing the addition, it's only telling it is the addition operation and it is having that instruction. And where are the operands? We have seen just before, the operands can be on the registers or it can be from the memory, right? So it can be on the memory or it can be from the registers, but that operation should be done by, addition should be done by somebody, that is carried out by the ALU. And finally, wherever the answer should be, that will be stored. We'll see this with an example. Yeah, these are all the five types of registers which are available inside the processor. So we have seen all these, like instruction register is responsible for holding the current instruction which is executing, is holding the instruction. Program counter is holding the address of the next instruction. And the general purpose registers are meant for holding the temporary answers. And memory address register is responsible for holding the memory address which is going to be given by the program counter. Memory data register will be having the data which is going to be written into the memory or which has fetched from the memory which is going to be used by the ALU. Yeah, let's see how the instruction will be executed actually using this. If I take a one instruction, add LOC A or not, what is exactly means? Just I am writing this in terms of our C language. R not is a register actually over here. Anything which starts with R over here, we call it as a register. So R0 is a register, and location A is a variable, memory location name. B which we are going to call it as a variable in C language, and R naught is the one more. Like it is just like one operand resides in the R naught, and the answer will be stored back in the R naught itself, and one more operand which is available in the memory. So now how this instruction is going to execute? Actually, before this, I just want to recall you the definition of program. The program from C language, we have seen that the definition is, it's a collection of instructions. I am telling it's a collection of instructions. Instructions means what? These are all the things. So every program is a collection of instruction. So each instruction is meant for doing some specific task. The combination of many instruction, you are going to call it as a program. So even here also, we are going to write a program, and all those programs are not in the standard statements, they are in the format of instructions. Now what I did, I am telling the processor to add R0 with location A and store the result back in R0. So we'll see what happens. Add the operand at the memory location A to the operand in the register R0. This register, where it resides, it's a general purpose register, it resides inside the processor. Place the sum into R0, it means final answer will be stored in the R0. The original content of location A, see, I am not modifying location A, I am just retrieving the data from location A. So of course the original content is preserved. And here what I did, I added with R0 with the content of location A, and I am overwriting on the R0. Of course I am going to lose the original content, I am going to get a new content on the R0. That's why it is called a temporary register. It's not a permanent, it's a temporary, it is used for temporary purpose. The instruction is fetched from memory into the processor. First, I should know what has to be done, right? This is a add operation. Where it should be, actually, add is the instruction. Where it should be on the instruction register, IR. Who is responsible for getting this? PC and MAR. PC and MAR are going to work together, and they will get this, and they will store this on the MDR. From MDR, it will go to the IR. And then ALU will decode this, and it will understand, yes, it's an add operation, it needs two operands, and those two operands where it resides. So it's going to, the instruction is going to tell, one operand is in the R0, one more operand is in the location A, it means memory. Again, it has to tell the PC to get the location A content on the MDR, so that I can get that directly and I can work on it. So that is how it's going to work. Now the operands at the location A is fetched and added to the content of R0. The resulting sum is stored back in the R0. So I hope you got an idea how this add instruction is going to work. So the diagram what I have shown is going to use this instruction, and have shown the sequences how it's going to work. Let's separate this instruction. What instruction I have taken previously, add LOCA R0. It's going to have memory operation and the addition operation together. Let's separate it. Let's separate the memory operation into first part, and second one is the addition operation. What I'm doing over here, on the memory operation, I'm loading the content of location A to R1. I'm bringing the location A content also to the part of on the temporary register R1. Already R0 is having a one operand. You know, addition, if I say it's a binary operation, that binary operation demands two operands, one is R1 and R0 over here. So now, rather than making this as location A, I'm asking you to go with the R1. So to do that, what you have to do is, first, before doing the addition operation, you should have the valid content on the R1. So that's what I'm going to fetch over here. This is called as a fetch stage. I'm going to get the location A content on the R1, then I'm performing the respective task of addition. Right now, can you tell which is going to be overwritten? Of course, this will be always source and this will be always destination in our discussion. So when it is a destination, of course it's going to overwrite the content of R0. R1 content will be preserved, as we have seen in the previous case. Next, we'll see all the steps with this diagram, how these are going to work. So here we can see the same instruction what I have written. See, in the first explanation I made it as a single instruction, then I converted it to two instructions. It depends why to convert. You may think that why we have to convert, like why we have, when it can be done in a single instruction, why we have to go with a two instruction. This is what I said about architecture base. I have shown you the in the demo that based on the architecture, the number of instructions will increase or it may decrease. So consider I am going with the one more architecture now, where it's going to demand me to place both the operands on the register. I cannot work on memory location directly. So this add instruction will tell I cannot work on memory location and one more in the register. I want both should be on the register, then only I can add. This is the rule of the add instruction. Then what I have to do, it is the programmer responsibility, bring everything, both the operands on the registers, then ask the processor to add those two. So first we'll see how actually this starts. Program resides in the memory through input devices. Yes, we are aware. We type the program and it will be resides in the memory. PC is set to point to the first instruction. What is the first instruction? First instruction initially is this. This is pointed first initially by the PC. And what PC will tell? Now PC is going to transfer. I said that address is given to the PC, MAR by PC. The PC is going to tell, take this address, get the first instruction. And now, once after this, immediately what PC will do is, once after it has given the address to MAR, it's going to update itself. It has to point to the next instruction. PC was pointing before to load, now it has to point to the add. In meantime, what all happens? MAR has to do? It has got a read signal. PC said, get this instruction. It means what? Read. Going to read the memory content, and that first instruction is from the readout and loaded into the, from the memory, it's going to load into the MDR. What I said, which is there in the memory, which is located by MAR, and that should be stored back to the MDR. I said via this way, and now it's coming to this way. Now decode and execute this instruction. Decode means what? What is this? I have to understand. Yes, load means what? What I actually have to do, right? I have to understand. I have decoded and I have executed. It means again, while decoding, I realize there is a location A and I have to get that data and I have to store over here. I have to store the data over here. That is what is I understood by decoding and executing this instruction. This is going to complete the first instruction execution. Next, we will see what happens. Next, we are going to perform the second operation. Second operation, I did not get this instruction yet, right? So for that, who is having the address of this? Before we said it is going to be held by the PC. So PC is going to transfer the address to this to MAR, and MAR will get that from the memory, and that MAR is going to tell, read this and store in MDR. MDR is going to get that content and that will go to instruction register. Actually in decode stage, it will go to instruction register. Now add is there over here and it is add. How I realized it is add, I have to perform the addition operation, that is through the decode stage. Once after the decode stage, I understood it is the addition operation. Addition means binary operation. Binary means two operands are required. So those two should be available. So already R1 I got it. R0 is already stored directly by the user or the programmer. Now what I have to do? I have to perform the addition operation. So IR tells the ALU, yes, you perform the addition operation and store the answer back on the R0. Store the answer back on the R0. This is what is done by the add instruction. So you can notice over here, perform the operation in ALU, store the results back. And again, as I said, once it's going to give the address to MAR, the PC will be updated and it's going to point to the next instruction. And the next instruction can be a end, the end of the program, right? It will stop that execution.